you just do what you normally do and that'll work for me.
Well, Paul, how did you get interested in gyroplanes to begin with?
Well, that's the question I could start with, right?
Yeah.
What drew you into gyroplanes initially?
Well, when I was a kid, I thought being a pilot would be the coolest job in the world. And I quickly did, I was good enough at math to realize my only way in was going to be through the military, because my family was not of means to train me privately to become a civilian airline pilot. And then I gradually grew to realize that with my vision, I was not a candidate to become a military pilot. And so I parked that dream on the shelf for decades, you know, when I was a teenager. And my other big dream in life was to become a radio disc jockey. I had been so enamored of the, you know, these guys who were on the top 40 radio stations in my youth. And I said, I want to do that. You know, I want to communicate with people that way and do that for my life. And so I got to the point where I was able to do that. I did radio for 30 years. And as my radio career was winding down, I found myself working at a small suburban AM talk radio station near Portland, Oregon. It was at the Hills. It had its studio in the terminal building of the Hillsborough Airport. Every year they have a big air show there. One of the things the radio station does is to provide wall-to-wall coverage of the weekend of all the aviation events going on. And it was, I was mildly interested. I had done work out of that studio and seen guys on Saturdays who were going out for their $100 hamburgers and their RVs and that sort of thing. But what really got me, what really bit me, was when I was at the air show and saw Jim Vanek do his loop and roll routine in the sport copter. Okay. And I said, what is that? I kind of knew what it was because the announcer told us that it was a home built and that it was 65 horsepower and all the details of it. I said, that's within range of dreaming. And so I went over to talk to Jim, and if anybody's talked to Jim after a performance in an air show, you know that if you spend 5 minutes with a guy, the hook's going to be set really deep. And so at the time, in that area where Sportcopter is based, they had just had a fatality involving their instructor and a student that took out their trainer. And Jim had plans for a much better trainer, but it was going to be a year or more before it was done. And both he and Dave Wiley, who was the examiner in the area, said, Paul, while you're waiting, go learn to fly tail draggers, airplanes, and get to the point where you've soloed and then come back. By then we'll have a trainer and you'll have some important skills under your belt. I got a little carried away and they got a little delayed, and by the time we got together again, I had 100 hours and a private airplane license. So I ended up working briefly part-time for Sportcopter, and really started to get involved in the old rotorcraft.com forum that preceded the current day Rotary Wing forum.
Sure.
And started to learn more and more. And then it came an opportunity to buy a Sportcopter Vortex out of an estate sale for a pretty good deal. And so I did that. Then I met Cindy, we got married, moved 4 times in fairly short duration. I wasn't making any progress on the kit, and somebody out of the blue offered to buy it from me. So I sold it because it really deserved to be finished. It's now flying in Pennsylvania. And in the intervening time, I've decided that I think I want something more basic. I want something closer to the original Benson ideal of, you know, 250 to 300 pounds, lightweight machine, simple systems, easy to trailer, all those things.
Cool.
And that's where I am today.
Okay. Well, somewhere else you are is on the forum a fair bit, on the U.S. Rotorcraft Forum. Can you tell me what it is that drives you to be on that forum, to participate in that forum? A couple of other fellows have told me why they're there, but I'd be curious to know why you're there in particular.
Well, the Rotary Wing Forum, like most special interest forums in the world on the internet, is a mix of a few cranks and a very deep knowledge pool. Some of the people who are on there, who I learn from, don't even think of themselves as part of the knowledge base. But I see, when I see people who are starting out making mistakes, bumping their heads into walls, I learn from that. And I just cannot imagine a more valuable resource or greater value in learning than to be on that forum. And one of the things my father had as a characteristic that I really admired him for was that when someone was straying off the the path of known truth into speculation and presenting it as fact, my dad could ask a very polite, friendly, pointed question, and either that person would either prove that they did know what they were talking about, or they would make a complete idiot of themselves. And I love watching for opportunities like that. I love to be able to ask a question of someone which forces them to reveal the source of their information or reveal that they don't have a source for their information. Because I find that better than a confrontational style, and I think it helps everybody else, and it keeps it a friendlier place. Some people will go out there and say, ah, you're full of it, you know. You don't know what you're talking about. That's not my style, but I do like to press further when I see somebody presenting what they say is knowledge, to see if it's really knowledge or whether it's speculation.
Sure, sure. You're also heavily involved in the as circulation manager, putting out the rotorcraft magazines, both the Southwest and Western rotorcraft magazines. Is that correct?
Yeah, it is. And that's an interesting way that developed, because I don't know if the experience is the same in Australia, but if you have a club here in the States, it's harder to find a newsletter editor than it is a president or any other position in the club. The newsletter editor has to chip away at that job constantly, all month long, in some cases. So I was the secretary, webmaster, and newsletter editor for Chapter 2, which is a fairly recently formed group, 2007, with about 25 members. I was the past president of Chapter 73 in the Portland, Oregon area, 700 miles away. They lost their editor. And those guys all knew me. I had been, you know, there for years, and before I moved to Utah. And I said to myself, you know, it's dumb for us both to invent that wheel every month. So I contacted them, said, you know, on a trial basis, why don't we try a pooled newsletter? We meet on the same day every month, so our deadlines will be, you know, coincident. And if you'll send me your minutes and any pictures or other feature material you have, I'll blend it with what we have, and then I'll get you a PDF that you can print and mail to your members. They were still doing postal mail to all their members. Well, we tried it, and it worked out well. I was able to balance it fairly well to provide both chapters with what seemed like as much exposure as they'd had in their individual newsletters, as well as filling in the slow months with things from the other chapter, so it worked out well. Well, then Chapter 1 in California was losing their editor. And so they joined on. And then Chapter 38 formed in Colorado. They didn't have an editor. They jumped in. Chapter 15 in Arizona had never had more than a single-page email each month to just announce meetings, so they came in. And then Chapter 31, which had been dormant for 10 years, came back to life in California, so it got six chapters in an 8-page newsletter. And I don't know how, but somehow everybody was happy with the amount of exposure they were getting, so we kept it going. Now it's 12 pages. We've managed to grow the community wider in the West. In the Western U.S., it's very difficult because of our lack of population density to have the kind of critical mass to feel like you have a group and things are happening that is common back in the eastern part of the U.S. And so now if we go to a fly-in 1,000 miles away, we get there, we get out of the truck, and right away people know us on site because we've seen each other in our activities in the newsletter. The evolution from there was Southwest Rotorcraft did a similar thing for chapters in another part of the country. What has evolved now is I served for a while as editor of, I was the one who was given the task of converting PRA's paper magazine to an electronic format. Got that started, handed that off to the current editor, Lisa Klutz. But they asked me to stay on and manage the email distribution, the database, that end of it. And a few months ago, we convinced PRA that it was in everyone's benefit to distribute the chapter regional newsletters through the same email list as the national publication. And now there are 10 chapters out there scratching for new subscribers, which helps the national. And the individual chapters, which maybe had 40 subscribers, now have 2,700, which makes advertising possible and a wider publicity for their events and activities. So I'm really pleased with how that's developed. My only reservation is I don't know what's going to happen to it all if I decide I can't do it anymore.
Sure. I can see that your past experience in radio and TV journalism has obviously lent itself to that whole process.
Well, and kind of an underrated part of that experience too was the marketing side of it, because when there's an opportunity to grow exposure, I'm immediately aware of it where some people may not be.
Sure.
Because I worked with hundreds and thousands of clients in the radio business putting ads together, trying to determine what their niche was, how to reach people with their unique message. So that has helped as well.
Okay, and so you mentioned you don't know what's going to happen if you leave the situation or the position. Is that something that you see on the near horizon, or are you in it for a bit longer yet?
I'm in it for the foreseeable future.
Okay.
I don't know where life will take me in terms of time commitments.
Yep.
But at this point, Western Rotorcraft is a labor of love, and the chapters that participate seem very pleased with what I do and don't have any critical comments. PRA is just simply the distribution side of it. I don't do any editing there, but I can manage it for now.
Okay. Are you actually affiliated with the PRA board? You seem fairly closely associated with all the board people that I see getting around here at Mentone at the moment.
Well, part of what happened about 2 years ago, the PRA launched a regional representatives program. And the idea was that there would be an intermediary who would be close to the chapters in a region and then in turn communicate to the board. It turned out to be an additional layer of administrative overhead that didn't really seem to facilitate better communication, so it's been discontinued. But I started writing a column each month, a very brief column, and providing it to the individual newsletters in the region, and that was part of the genesis of Western Rotorcraft, the combined regional newsletter pool, because if I'm going to be writing content for everybody's newsletters, it's not a big leap to just put them all together as one newsletter.
Yeah. Well, I certainly appreciate receiving the what do you call them? The e-alert emails.
There's a couple of things. The e-alert is what we call the monthly email that goes out. There's usually two a month. Mm-hmm. Rotorcraft e-zine usually publishes on about the 15th of the month. That's the international. And then the chapter newsletters generally go out about a week earlier than that, usually the 7th or 8th of the month.
Okay. Now, one of the interesting things I found myself discussing you with the other night was engines and engine development. And you seem to have a fair amount of knowledge about what's out there and what's coming online. And you spoke about a couple of engines that you might be interested in. Would you care to share that with us?
Well, we have some unique needs in Utah, where I'm based now. Our valley floor is about 4,200 feet or 1,300 meters above sea level. And then if you want to go anywhere from there on a hot summer day, you're talking about density altitudes of 8,000 or 10,000 feet. There's some fantastic canyon flights to do in our area, but to do them, you've got to climb quickly a couple thousand feet out of an airport that's already at 7,500 density altitude. So I've put a lot of research into engines, and there's no particular one that jumps out at me. They're all compromises of some sort. The two strokes are light. Some of them are very powerful, but they're thirsty and less reliable. I've looked at some newer four strokes that all fall short for me in some way. I looked very hard at the Aero Twin for a while. Wanted to not be an early adopter of that. I wanted to wait until we saw if the horsepower quoted was Clydesdales or Shetland ponies.
Yep.
And there are a couple of other engines that are kind of in that boat. The Aero Twin also had a very radical cooling system that involved blowing oil or air through the crankcase. I wanted to see how successful their air-oil separation scheme was before I put an automatic coating device for my tail on my gyroplane. I don't really know how that's turned out for sure, but I think they're still working with that. There's a little engine called the Hexadyne P60 that's made near me in Utah, which I don't believe is making claimed horsepower. There are a number of other engines that impress me in one way or another, but are too expensive. So, living where I live is part of why I've been so interested in engines for the past few years.
Okay. What about Todd's Yaminator engine development?
That is an extremely promising engine, especially for lighter two-place machines. The problem is that Todd's a hobbyist. He's not really in it as a business at this point. And until someone is, I build because I have to build. I'm not a builder, I'm a flyer. And so if I can't pick up the phone and get a part, I don't have the wherewithal to go down and, you know, turn on the barn light and fire up the lathe and make my own replacement parts. So at this point, that's kind of the drawback with a lot of those. The Weber is another one where the support for the engine is not as solid as a Rotax or one of the major manufacturers.
Okay. You had a very successful rotor over the Rockies this year, 2012. Good turnout, a lot of good flying, and yourself and Kevin Ritchie were able to move forward in your own progress.
That was me and Glenn Kerr, actually.
Oh, Glenn Kerr, sorry, sorry.
Well, it was successful in a number of ways. The Utah Rotorcraft Association has split off from the PRA chapter that founded, that was originated it. We made URA specifically a IRS government-recognized not-for-profit charity focused on education. And we did that because it enables us to more flexibility and strength in drawing donations. And there is a tremendous need to develop training resources in the western U.S. For example, California, a very populous state. There's not a single active instructor in California. One of our first expressed goals for URA was to get two CFIs, two instructors, with machines that were legal to train at Rotors Over the Rockies so that people who needed a sign-off from two instructors to get an advancement knew they could come there and get it. We pulled that off this year. So in that sense, we were very successful. And Glenn and I both already had our private airplane certificates. We were seeking to add the sport pilot gyroplane to that.
Oh, I see.
And that requires two instructors but no examiner, so we were able to do that. We also got a lot of people introductory rides and instruction. There was a guy there from Florida, a guy from Seattle. They came from quite far, in part drawn by our scenery and our environment.
Sure.
We were actually down a little bit in attendance because many people told us that they were saving their vacation time and their money to come to the 50th PRA annual convention in Mentone.
Which is where we're sitting now.
Right. But some great video has come out on YouTube. Glenn Kerr, in fact, did a canyon flight with instructor Desmond Butts that is a flying over a precipice to reveal a, I think it's about a 2,000-foot sheer rock wall down to a quarry at the bottom, and it's spectacular.
Yeah.
And we finally are starting to be able to show the world the place we have to fly, and there are people from quite a distance off saying, I had no idea I'm going to be there next year.
Yeah.
So I think attendance will be up again next year.
So am I wrong in recollecting that Kevin was actually there as well, flying his...
He was there
Lightning?
Flying...
He was, yeah.
Flying a sport copter.
I seem to remember he was in some of the pictures and videos, yeah.
I should mention, too, that Kevin has been a human spark plug for our sport in our part of the country. Kevin has been extremely generous in letting other people fly his machine. And, for example, at Rotors Over the Rockies, as we sit here talking now about 14 months ago, Glenn Kerr was very discouraged. He was struggling to find training when and where he needed it. He has a terrible work schedule for accommodating that. And he was about to go fixed wing, get an airplane. And at Rotors Over the Rockies 2011, Kevin let Glenn taxi his machine around. Just taxi it around. No blade spinning, just kind of get a feel for differential braking, sit in the seat, hand on the stick. It got Glenn so fired up that he wound up at Mentone last year, 12 months ago this week, found a machine, bought it, went to Georgia to train with Steve McGowan, got some more training with Mike Burton in Utah. And this year, a couple months ago at Rotors Over the Rockies, he got his sport pilot add-on, and now he's flying his own machine here.
Oh, that's a great story. I mean, I just love watching the videos that Glenn's pumping out as well.
Yeah.
In that mountain area where he's flying.
Well, and Kevin Ritchie also has done something similar for Terry Smith, who is the president of Chapter 1 in California, got re-energized in his goals by taxiing Kevin's machine at El Mirage. Kevin actually stayed a week after Rotors Over the Rockies last year so I could use his machine and fly off the 10 hours of solo requirements for the private gyroplane license.
Fantastic.
Which I did in the area south of where I live.
Excellent.
And so he has revved up enthusiasm like nothing else I've seen.
Okay, so I was going to ask you, what future goals have you set yourself in the sport? And I guess one of those is to build this single place basic Benson-type machine.
Yeah, I...
anything else?
I've been through a rough patch employment-wise, and if it was just me, I'd go live in the corner of somebody's hangar and build a machine anyway.
Sure.
But having a wife and the attendant responsibilities, I've been an adult.
Yeah.
And now things are better, and I'm expect to be ready to fly, you know, by this time next year in my own machine.
Fantastic.
So that's my goal.
All right, and look, this has been excellent, being able to chat to you in this way. And actually spend time with you here at Mentone, the 50th. It's been fantastic. But I do have one final question, and that would be anyone new coming into the system. Obviously, I've got a lot from your input on the forum over the years, and I PM'd you privately, and you've been fantastic to help to me in several aspects of the industry. But someone new coming in, wanting to fly a gyroplane, main pieces of advice you'd give them as they come in?
Okay. I guess my main piece of advice, this is going to be somewhat biased toward the environment in the U.S. because it's the one I know.
Mm-hmm.
Get an introductory flight, whether it's logged as training or whether your legal environment allows you to just take a paid intro flight or ride, or get a ride with a friend. Experience a number of different machines. Different things appeal to different people. As you guys say, horses for courses, right?
Yep.
I see a lot of people commit time, money, and get waist deep into a project that they later decide is not for them. Whether it's the sport in general, I mean, I've seen people get down the road and build a machine, and it comes time to fly it, they start taking training, and they realize that it panics them to death. They can't fly one. That's awful when that happens, you know. But at a lower level, find out what machine, whether you want an open machine, completely open, windshield, pod, full enclosure, side-by-side, tandem. Try to fly the different machines and see what's right for you. The other thing is, set aside the pile of money up front to train. Don't get it in spurts because it's not efficient to take a year off. And the other thing is, just put up with whatever static there is to participate in the forums and the politics of your local organizations and that sort of thing, because there's a knowledge base there that, especially in the gyroplane sport, doesn't seem to find its way to paper often. And you find it by going to events, talking to people, reading on the forum, and going through that process. And you just have to learn to be dismissive of the things that bug you.
Excellent. Well, that's good advice. And, mate, I appreciate your input on the forum. It's certainly helped me in my learning curve, and I'm sure a lot of other fellas feel exactly the same way. So,
and I may be biased in this comment, too, but read all the publications you can.
Yeah.
You know, over here we've got some great ones free. PRA's Rotorcraft is about to go back to a members-only status, but join PRA. Pay the $42 a year. It's a tremendous investment.
Excellent. Thanks for your time, Paul.
All right.
Fantastic.
Enjoy your stay in the States.
Thank you very much.